Hi, this is Daryl Myatt from Keller, Texas. Today is Thursday, May 15th, 2014. This channel is all about world news, Bible prophecy, end time events, and the return of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Please forgive me today. There's something in the air. I don't know. Yesterday, I was in an intersection and this big truck went by and I smelled this odor. And ever since then, I've had a seriously sore throat. Coughing. I don't know what was in that truck, but it wasn't good, whatever it was. I don't know. Maybe it's the powers that be trying to get rid of people like me. Anyway, let's get right into it today. Have a look at some things going on. Out of End of the American Dream, headline says, the incredible shrinking U.S. military. It says, by the end of this decade, the U.S. Army will be the smallest that it has been since World War II. The U.S. Navy will be the smallest that it's been since World War I. And the U.S. Air Force will have gotten rid of over 500 planes. Without a doubt, the U.S. military has not been used wisely in recent years, but the world is not becoming a more stable place either. The threat of war appears to be greater than it has been in a very long time, and yet the Obama administration seems obsessed with gutting our national defenses. So exactly what is Obama's agenda anyway? In a world that's getting crazier with each passing day, why would he want to steadily shrink the size of the U.S. military? Who's he serving? Is he serving America's best interests or his Muslim Brotherhood's best interest? I'm not going to read all of this story, but suffice it to say, our military is at the lowest levels in numbers that they've been in nearly 100 years in some cases. At a time when Russia's invading other places, Iran is threatening to go nuclear and wipe Israel off the face of the earth, North Korea threatens America daily with nuclear missiles, China. Is it really the time to start cutting our military? Is this really in America's best interest? Why are we giving millions and millions of dollars to the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt and cutting our own military? Anyone got any ideas there? Maybe Obama's not really supporting America's best interests. 500 planes. Doesn't make sense. The Navy getting smaller. The Marines getting smaller. Army getting smaller. Everyone getting smaller. Don't think that's the right direction we want to go. Obama is saying that he wants to ultimately reduce our nuclear arsenal down to just 300 warheads. You know, back in 1967, we had more than 31,000 nuclear warheads. Now, I admit, that's probably a little overkill. I don't think 31,000 could alter the path of the Earth through space. We could change the direction of the rotation of the Earth with 31,000 nuclear bombs. And it looks like that START treaty that Obama signed back in 2010 limits both the United States and Russia to a maximum of 1,550 strategic nuclear warheads. Now that seems like plenty, don't you think? 31,000, that's a little overkill. But just exactly who is he serving with reducing America's defense at a time when the rest of the world seems to be growing? China, Russia, both spending crazy amounts of money on their military. They're growing in power and strength and size while we dwindle ours. Does this make sense to anybody? Anyway, just thought I'd throw that out there because you won't hear that much. Speaking of won't hear that much, here's a story you probably haven't even heard anywhere. You know, I don't know if you've heard about this mine explosion in Turkey yesterday. It's killed over 245 people already. Another 120 are feared dead or trapped. right after this crisis broke out, Israel offered to help Turkey after this mining explosion killed 245 people. A day after, Turkey had said, you know what, Israel is the problem. Israel needs to go. Israel needs to stop occupying Palestinian land. And the very next day, Israel offers to help them when they have a crisis. Has anyone heard this story? I'm reading this one out of Virtual Jerusalem. It says, Israel offers to help Turkey after mining explosion kills 245. One day after Turkey pretty much raked Israel over the coals. How come no one's talking about it? Oh yeah, because that would paint Israel in a positive light. Oh, I forgot. The world agenda against God's chosen people. Yeah, okay, I forgot. Silly me. I shouldn't do anything to speak kindly and speak well of the Jewish people, because after all, they're just God's chosen people in His chosen land. Speaking of, here's out of Israel Today, Jerusalem imam says to Muslims, invade Israel. An imam at the Al-Aqsa Mosque on Jerusalem's Temple Mount has publicly urged the armies of the Arab world to invade Israel and fulfill the great Muslim longing of destroying the hated Zionist regime. This was a televised sermon from Milan, Italy, that was broadcast by Al Jazeera. Imam Raed al-Da'an said that Muslims everywhere are beginning to realize that the Jewish state will vanish and that the morning sun will rise on Palestine. Very interesting. Moving on. Let's see. Oh, here's one of my favorite kind of stories. This also out of Israel Today. It says, Muslim goes to Mecca and finds Jesus. A Turkish Muslim who made a pilgrimage to Mecca in a desperate attempt to get his life back on track returned as a Christian to the great astonishment of his family. He's now a pastor. Ali Pektash has been addressing a conference in Jerusalem called At the Crossroads and sees it as part of his mission to help reunite the sons of Abraham. Ali was a Kurd. He suffered from alcohol addiction. His friend said, hey, go make your Hajj, the pilgrimage to Mecca, to Islam's holiest city. And it was in Saudi Arabia, where liquor is banned, that they thought this religious ritual might cure him. When he got there, he cried out to God for help, if indeed he was there, and he fell asleep. Jesus then appeared to him in a dream and touched him, saying, you believe in me now. Leave this place. So after he got out of the shower the next morning, he discovered what he thought was dust on part of his chest, where Jesus had touched him in his dream. But in fact, the hair on his chest had turned white in the shape of a hand. And at the traditional celebration marking his return from the Hajj, he announced to his family he had seen Jesus in Mecca and had come back a Christian. He burst out crying in front of his wife, asking her for forgiveness for the way he had treated her, clearly demonstrating a very dramatic change in his life. He says it could only be done through Jesus. Everybody in Turkey says they believe in God, but people are persecuting me, and they don't believe in the real God, he says. That's the kind of thing I love to see. Love it, love it, love it, love it. Out of Israel Today, Defense Minister Moshe Ya'alon says that all means must be used to block Iran threat. Of course, talking about the nuclear threat. He says everything should be used. The Jewish state and its U.S. allies should be prepared to use all means to prevent Iran from obtaining a nuclear weapons capability, as Iran is inching ever closer to having that capability. We're going to see Israel do something. You know, Israel struck Saddam Hussein's nuclear reactors back in 1981, took them out, wouldn't even let them, I mean, they weren't even partially complete. Just took him out. It was like a warning. He's like, yeah, we're not going to let you do that. Syria, just, what, 5-6 years ago, Israel took out Syria's nuclear reactor. Took it out. Now they're saying, Iran is getting way too close. Something needs to be done. Now, Iran's not going to just sit back and be like, oh, darn, you bombed our nuclear facility. I guess we'll start building bricks or something now. Iran won't respond that way. Iran will respond with something kind of similar to Ezekiel 38:39. Oh, wait. That probably will be their response, Ezekiel 38:39, where they lead a world army against Israel because of that. We'll soon see. We have a skeletal outline of things that will happen prior to the return of Christ. We don't have the smaller details, but I think we're going to see them fall into place, many of them very soon. Man, I can barely breathe. I don't know what was in that truck. And my voice, whew. Here's a story out of Yahoo. Putin's new Russia takes shape in eastern Ukraine. Boy, Russia. Vladimir Putin last month described regions of eastern and southern Ukraine as a new Russia that could one day return to Moscow's control. And now we're seeing that vision taking shape. Russia's widely condemned annexation of Crimea in March and Putin's increasing rhetoric about protecting Russian speakers abroad has raised fears the Kremlin was gearing up to seize more territory. I'm not going to read the rest of this story, but Russia stepping up, making their military might known around the world. And Obama's reaction? Let's reduce the size of our military. That sounds like a good plan. How about this? Out of the economic collapse, cities all over America are becoming extremely cruel to the homeless. People without homes. They're giving them tickets. They're giving them one-way bus tickets out of town saying, leave. They're fining people for feeding them. Fining people. There's a couple in Florida that has made it their mission to feed homeless people, and they've been fined some $400 each for passing out sandwiches and soup to homeless people. Where's the love? Oh, Jesus told us in Matthew 24, Mark 13, Luke 21, the love of many would grow cold. Ticketing people for feeding homeless people. Some of the most down and out, destitute people in America or anywhere in the world. And we can't help them? You're going to fine people for trying to help? For trying to be neighborly? For trying to be godlike? For trying to obey God's commandments? Love God, love others. Jesus said the two greatest commandments. Love God, love others. So, expressing love to others by trying to help them, giving a brother some food, giving a sister some water. Oh, I'm going to write you a ticket for that. You shouldn't be doing this. These people are homeless. They're despicable. They treat them like human garbage. This is the world we live in, people. This is the America that we now live in. Start taking prayer out of school. Start taking God out of everything. And then they want to say, God bless America. And God's like, yeah, you guys are on your own. You don't want me. 2 Chronicles 7:14 just screams to this country. It screams out, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land. People, this is what America is in dire need of right now. We need to get rid of these godless leaders. We need to get rid of these anti-American leaders who want to fund the Muslim Brotherhood and reduce our military. Can you not see what his intentions clearly are? He's trying to weaken us. Obama is trying to bring America down to her knees. Now, and then you get to this little tricky area. It's like, okay, probably has to happen anyway for other Bible prophecy to be fulfilled. So do we try to stop what we see as an evil and a wicked thing? Or do we try to say, you know, that's probably part of God's plan. It probably has to happen. That's one of those things where I don't know. I mean, Abraham was negotiating with God. Hey God, suppose you find 50 people in Sodom and Gomorrah. Will you spare the city for that? Sure, God said. Loosely translated. How about 40? Okay. How about 30? Oh, well, all right. How about 20? You know God already knew how many righteous people were in Sodom and Gomorrah. He had the upper hand. I mean, let's face it. But Abraham's negotiating with him. It's like, it seems to me that America's Constitution is probably one of the only things keeping the one world government from forming. Someone had to trample on our Constitution, make it less effective. I give you Barack Hussein Obama. He's doing exactly what he's been put in place to do. We're going to see a lot of things we don't like. We're going to see a lot of things we think are pure evil. But God is using that for his plan, for his glory, for reasons far and above us that we can't understand. So when we see America, land that I love, land of the free, home of the brave, at least currently, for now, tomorrow might be a different story, when we see her falling, sliding straight to hell, it's natural for us to want to rescue America, for us to want to help, for us to stand up and say, things have to change. But would we just be in the way of God's progress? It's one of those things. You're like, what do I do, Lord? What do I do? Do I just sit back and watch? Do I try to be a voice to help affect a change, a godly change? It's still my hope that America in the last days will be a safe haven for Christians. That hope seems to be dwindling. I can't help but think about in Revelation when it talks about the wings of a great eagle protected her for 3.5 years, speaking of Israel. I still want to hope that that's America it's talking about. Just me, I guess. I don't know. Sometimes it's really hard watching this country that I love becoming what it's becoming. And it's sad. Out of Yahoo, Sudan judge sentences Christian woman to death for apostasy. A Sudan judge today sentenced a Christian woman to hang for apostasy, despite appeals by Western embassies that freedom of religion should be respected. They said, we gave you 3 days to recant, but you insist on not returning to Islam. I sentence you to be hanged to death. So you leave that cult, they kill you. Sounds like a religion of peace to me, doesn't it, you? When is the world going to wake up and see that this cult is from hell itself? Ran by Satan himself, Allah, who brags about being the greatest deceiver of all. They worship a great liar. Did you see this? Out of Christian headlines, newly discovered synagogue could be where Jesus taught. They're talking about this area, a salvage dig. I drove right by this dig. I saw it. We almost stopped and got out to look, but there was kind of a fence up, and you know, I would have jumped it, but still. It's over by Magdala Synagogue is what they're calling this. It's one of only 7 uncovered in Israel that was used during the first century when the Jerusalem temple still stood. They say they found a stone that was likely used as the table where the Torah was read. Now, this is in the area around where Christ would have delivered, like, the Sermon on the Mount. It's called Migdal, but it was actually, the ancient name was Magdala, which was where Mary Magdalene came from. Very interesting. Now I wish I would have stopped and gotten out and looked. But they're saying, yeah, this is probably one of the sites where Jesus taught. How can we worship God in a world that seems to be so godless? In a world that wants to shut up Christians? In a world that wants to say, yeah, that's probably not appropriate. You know what? Jesus Christ is the only way to God the Father. Whether you like it or not, whether you believe it or not, whether you accept it or reject it or not, truth will still be truth no matter what. Let's go to Daniel 6, verse 10. Daniel 6, verse 10. My throat feels like it's just restricted and I can't even breathe. Daniel 6, verse 10. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house, and his windows being open to his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees three times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God, as he did aforetime, like he always did. I think it's sad but somehow interesting how often the world tells us, oh, you know, calm down on that Jesus thing. You know, don't get so fired up about praying and worshiping. You know, some say, you can pray in your head, pray silently, don't pray out loud. Especially don't use that Jesus name. You know, military chaplains are being told, you can't pray in Jesus' name. Just take the Jesus out. Trying to remove God from everything. Let me just remind people, God is in everything. God created everything. Everything. Even what you might think is evil. Isaiah 45, verse 7, tells us, actually, I'm just going to read it to you. Sorry, I didn't know I was going to read Isaiah 45, verse 7. This is God talking. He says, I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create evil. I, the Lord, do all these things. Some people like to say, oh, God doesn't create evil. That might sound really nice, but it ain't biblical. Because my Bible says God does create evil. You know, some people say, oh, you can pray silently, or when you're worshiping, quit singing so loud. You know, just, you know, lip sync like Madonna and Miley Cyrus. Just, you know, just go along with everybody else. But when it came to Daniel, it was very clear where Daniel stood. When he was told he couldn't pray to God, he sat right by his window, and he did just like he had always done, got on his knees at least three times a day, and prayed. Now, I have to admit, God had given me a rebellious spirit. And sadly, in my younger years, I didn't focus it in the right areas. Let's just leave it at that. But I'm starting to learn as I get older, starting to see why God made me the way He did, why He wired me the way He did. And I can see that there's coming a time very soon when that rebellious spirit will speak out against a government that's going against God. I mean, I'm already doing it. What can we learn from Daniel? Now, we shouldn't just be abrasive for the sake of being abrasive and just getting attention. But also, you got a choice to make. Are you here to please God or are you here to please man? Because see, if you aim to please man, yeah, it might last a few years while you're here, and then what? You're gone. Life is over. Then what? Where are those men then? But if you aim to please God, no matter what man wants to do, that will always work out for you better in the long run. I promise you. Now, we shouldn't be like overly irritating either when it comes to our praise and worship. You know, we can learn from Daniel that we need to stand strong in our faith. Stand strong on what we believe and know to be right and true and holy. And that's not a very popular way of thinking in this twisted world today, in this ever increasingly dark world. And it's not going to get any easier. It's only going to get worse. I'm trying to help you guys get prepared for what's coming, because it is coming. There's a lot of people watching and praying, looking at the signs, not caring who's winning American Idol, not caring who's in the NBA playoffs. Yeah, my team's out anyway. There's far more important things than what this world wants to throw at you. This world, it shuns the truth, follows after myths and fables and whatever their itching ears want to hear. People are becoming lovers of pleasure and lovers of themselves more than lovers of God. This too is biblical. Timothy speaks about this. Actually, it was Paul, but it was written to Timothy. So make sure you're grounded in your faith. Make sure you build your faith upon the rock that is Jesus Christ, because this world is filled with shifting sands in our culture. What's popular today might be gone tomorrow. So be steady in your faith and endure to the end, because Jesus said the same shall be saved, he that endures to the end. Let's go to Proverbs 10, verse 29. Proverbs 10:29 says, "The way of the Lord is strength to the upright, but destruction shall be to the workers of iniquity." Some of the earliest explorers that left Spain and Europe and other parts that crossed the oceans, they learned a very valuable lesson quite quickly. And this was, you got to think back, this was long before radar, sonar, cell phones, GPS, you know, navigational boards, all this stuff. The currents of the ocean would carry them to their destination if they followed them correctly. Now, those currents could also send them the wrong way if they ignored them. The very same current could either have a very positive effect or a negative effect on a ship. It all depends on the knowledge and how the crew responds to it. Okay? Now, God's wisdom, in several ways, is like these currents of the ocean. It can carry us where we need to go. It is our refuge, the means to keep us safe and to bring us to our desired destination. But only if we follow it. I think the benefit of wisdom only applies to those who are willing to line up with it and set their course accordingly. Otherwise, those very same currents could lead to your ruin. And then there's that huge, huge group of people fighting the current. They're trying to swim against it, going everything opposite of what the Holy Bible says. History's filled with millions of people who tried to follow a path that was contrary to God's will. Now, it could have been a false religion. Could have been a wrong philosophy. It could have been some kind of personal ambition, a political agenda, an economic strategy, some kind of military feat, or any other thing that we humans in our horrible ignorance might have set our hearts on. You know, millions of people go against the currents of God and fail all the time. Their end is miserable. Their end is hell. What once looked so promising was found to be futile, chasing after the wind, Ecclesiastes says. Nothing new under the sun. So, examine yourself. Do you have a personal agenda? Do you have plans for your future? Have a close look at them. And ask yourself, if they're thoroughly consistent with God's will for your life. I mean, if you might sail comfortably for thousands of miles, thinking you're headed in the right direction, only to find out that you're very far off, completely off course. Even a slight variation in the beginning can lead you thousands of miles off course in the end. So we need to plan accordingly, learn the currents, and take refuge in the wisdom of God. Okay? Let's go to 1 John 5. 1 John 5. Let's look like verses 3 through 12. I'm not going to read them all, but starting in 3, "For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not grievous. For whatsoever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcomes the world? But he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God." Verse 7, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one." Father, Word, and the Holy Ghost. Word being Jesus, of course. "And there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he hath testified of his Son. He that believes on the Son of God has the witness in himself. He that believes not God has made him a liar." Has made him a liar. But God can't lie. "Because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God has given to us eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has life. And he that has not the Son of God has not life." If you don't know Jesus Christ as the Son of God, God in flesh and the Savior of the world, you don't have everlasting life. You don't know God the Father who sent him. Good health is on everyone's mind these days, I think. There's all kinds of books and diets and bestseller stuff. Nutrition stores, health clubs, gyms all over town. Of course, they're right next to the fast food restaurants most of the time. Late night television's always showing you these gadgets and gizmos designed to get you in the best shape of your life. Oh, sit there and just sit on the couch eating, and these things will electroshock your muscles into a beautiful shape. Yeah, good luck with that. Why do you think the health industry is such a profitable, booming business? It's because people want to live as long as possible. We want to look as good as possible for as long as we can. We want to be as healthy as we can. We have this desire to live long and prosper. What is that, Star Trek? Live long and prosper. Something like that. My buddy Kevin could tell you all about that. We want quality of years, but people also want the highest quality of life. This emotional need for a long, healthy life is centered around this physical world, this fallen physical world. But what about life after death? How concerned are people for that? You know, Scripture makes it very clear that eternal life is available to every person on earth. Romans 10:13. You know, we got sickness, disease, and death all over the world, all over this planet. But everyone in Christ has already overcome this world. Namely, death. 1 John 5, 4 through 5. So, despite their emotional appeal, these television infomercials can't offer you anything compared with the promise of eternal life that Christ brings. As believers, we should be shouting this from the rooftops, all over the place, all over Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. You know, why are people around us yearning for a word of life, but too many Christians have remained silent? How can we keep secret what God went to such great lengths to reveal? You can live forever. But it's only through Jesus Christ that you can do so. Isaiah 48:10 says, "I have chosen thee in the furnace of affliction." Now, you need to take comfort in this because it's talking about election. Okay? Comfort yourself with this thought. God says, "I have chosen thee." in the furnace of affliction. I've chosen thee in the furnace of affliction. That fire is hot, but he's chosen me. The coals, they're burning. I don't like where I am in this furnace of affliction, but he's chosen me. And then you feel this soft breeze on your face while you're in this furnace of affliction, like some gentle wind. And this thought comes across your mind while you have on your fireproof armor against which the heat has no power. Let affliction come. God has chosen me. Poverty, you might come knocking at my door. God is in the house already. He's chosen me. Son of Man is in that chamber with you, just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar said, wait, didn't we throw three guys in? I see four, and the fourth looks like the Son of God. Jesus was in the furnace of affliction with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They didn't burn. Their clothes didn't even smell like smoke. Keep in mind, the guards that opened the door instantly died because the furnace was so hot. God has chosen you. He consecrates you. He loves you. He's with you. You know, there's some things that can only be proved in times of trouble. Daniel 3:17, Daniel 3:25, 28, and 29, James 1:12, 1 Peter 1:6 and 7. Some things can only be tried through the affliction. Let's talk about the sinlessness of Christ. Christ was without sin. Now, when we talk of Christ's sinlessness, we're typically referring to his humanity. I mean, keep in mind, Jesus was 100% man, but he was also 100% God. And I know a lot of you are going, wait, that math doesn't add up. It adds up in God's math, okay? He was fully man, he was fully God. But it's unnecessary, I think, to talk about the sinlessness of Christ's deity because, I mean, deity by definition cannot and does not sin because it's holy and perfect. So the doctrine of Christ's sinlessness, I think, has been free of any controversy over the years. Even the biggest critics in history haven't denied the sinlessness of Christ. But his sinlessness doesn't just serve as an example to us. I mean, it's necessary for our salvation. Had Christ not been the Lamb without blemish, he couldn't have secured anyone's salvation, but would have needed a Savior himself, which he didn't. I mean, all the sins that Christ bore on the cross required a perfect sacrifice. John the Baptist, when he first saw him, said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." The Lamb of God. That sacrifice had to be made by one who was sinless. Christ was completely free of any transgression. He broke none of God's holy law. You know, he obeyed whatever God commanded. Now, even though he was sinless, Christ obeyed Jewish law. Probably even circumcision. Baptism, we know for sure. And maybe even the system of animal sacrifice. There's so much about Christ we don't know. You know, we hear about his birth, and from the time till he was about 2, you know, they went to Egypt, they came back, Herod died. But then from 2, you hear again, like when he's 12, they left him in the temple, like, he's driving away. Where's Jesus? He's in the backseat asleep. Nope, don't see him back there. Oh, I think we left him at the temple. I'll turn around, right? They're turning around. Go back, he's there teaching in the temple. Probably this one they found, possibly. There's so much we don't know. You know, his ministry starts, he's about 33 when he's baptized. 30, 33, somewhere in there. Or maybe he was 33 when he died. So, you know, you hear about him at 2, 12, and 30. And for the rest of his life, until he's crucified. So there's a lot of things we don't know. We don't know what he was doing. He was committed to doing the will of his Father, quite clear. It was said that the zeal he had for his Father's house consumed him in John 2:17, and that his meat was to do the will of his Father in John 4, 34. And Hebrews 4:15 it says, "For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin." Now, if Christ was tempted as we are, how could he have been sinless? Now, see, here's something else. God can't be tempted. First of all, Satan tried to tempt him. Okay, I think that's something that needs to be clearly made. James 1, 14 through 15, "But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death." You know, James is talking about a kind of temptation that comes from sinful desires within us. Jesus said, "Out of the heart come all kinds of sinful things, murderous thoughts and envy and adultery and wickedness." The heart. Jesus didn't have sinful desires. Okay? He was pure. I think this is the point of the qualifier, "yet without sin," in the book of Hebrews. Sure, Jesus had desires, but they weren't sinful ones. You know, when Satan tried to tempt him, the assault came from the outside. It wasn't from within himself. It was an external temptation. Satan tried to entice Jesus to eat during that period of fasting. You know, Jesus surely had a physical hunger. There's a couple of times where Jesus said, "I'm hungry," even after his death, burial, and resurrection. He had a desire for food, but there's no sin in being hungry. Okay? I mean, all things equal, Jesus wanted to eat. He went without food for 40 days. Okay, most of you guys couldn't go 40 hours, much less 40 days. Longest I've ever gone is 4 days. I fasted 4 days one time. I've done 3 days a couple other times. I can't imagine 40 days. The first day is probably the hardest. You're like, "Well, okay." It's not. Actually, the second day is probably the toughest. Because then by the third day, you're like, "I could probably go a few more. Yeah, no big deal at this point." 40, though, I can't even imagine. I'd be a twig and blow away if that were the case. But Jesus was committed to obeying the will of his Father. He had no desire to sin. It was by his sinlessness that Jesus qualified himself as the perfect sacrifice for our sins. See, one man, if he had sin, could only provide salvation for one other man. But Christ, who was without sin of any kind, could provide salvation for an unlimited number of people who would come to believe that he is who he said he is, and he did what the Bible says he did. It was not only necessary for Jesus to be our substitute and to receive the full punishment that was due to us because of our sins, but he also had to fulfill the law of God perfectly to secure the merit and the favor necessary for us to receive the blessings of God's covenant. Jesus didn't just die as the perfect for the imperfect, the sinless for the sinful, but he lived the life of perfect obedience required for our salvation. It was necessary that Christ was without sin for our sake. You know, Jesus made atonement as the Lamb without blemish. Christ wasn't tempted by sinful desires. Do you know him? Do you understand he paid the price for all your sins? Past, present, future. It doesn't matter what you've done. Christ will forgive you. He can wash you clean. Romans 10:9 says, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved." You want to be saved? You want to live forever? There's a way. His name is Jesus. God bless you guys. Good Lord willing, I'll see you again tomorrow.